I did have a handful of questions from people about different grad school things, and I have a computer here, so I'm going to be looking may a little bit in this direction when I read things off. So first off, I had a question about how you find research problems for PhD research, and that's a tricky one because essentially I'm not doing PhD level research yet. So I'm still in like the core course segment of my PhD program where I'm taking a lot of classes that are similar to what a master's student would take. And so depending on where you go, your research either comes from working on a problem with your advisor and making that your own thing over time, or it is kind of generative, or at least from most of the other PhD students that I know that are one in my department and also at other places who I've known from undergrad are doing things that are like, it's a problem that their advisor was like, hey, this would be interesting to look at. Can we say anything about this? And then you sort of take the tools that you have and look at some resources and try to push something further. So at least at PhD level, it's a little bit more difficult. But for undergraduate research, the best thing that you can do as an undergrad looking for research opportunities is to, well, there's always the like out of the box suggestion of apply to REUs and try to get your head in the door there, or foot in the door. That's the phrase. So try to get your foot in the door with REUs. But the thing that a lot of undergrads don't realize is that you can just talk to your professors. And oftentimes, showing an interest in material that your professor cares about is enough to at least start learning about what they do. And if you learn about what they do, usually there are some smaller problems that may or may not be accessible to you. I know that when I was an undergrad, the best thing that I did was I went through all of the math department people's CVs, and I looked at a handful of papers after I had taken a few proof-based writing classes, and I tried to figure out whose stuff I was interested in based on the knowledge that I had at the time. And then I would go into office hours with said professor, and I would talk about their stuff with them or what they are interested in, and see if I like my understanding, my limited understanding that I had from skimming through their research and how they talked about it meshed well. The reason that I know or have a good basis for learning more, because the lesson of a PhD is that you actually know nothing. So the good basis that I have for symbolic dynamics actually came from doing this with my undergraduate advisor. And it turned out that over the summer I was like working in admissions, and so I would spend my lunch breaks basically showing up and being like, I have this book on this subject, can we talk about it? And that turned into some like random, I say random because they didn't become papers, but like some random inquiries into different types of symbolic dynamical systems that I got to just like kind of play with. So when it comes to research and finding research topics, it's good to ask people who are doing the thing, which can be hard to do. It can be intimidating, but that is how I have been able to, one, be a part of research style opportunities as an undergrad, and two, mentor as a graduate student. So I showed a good, great interest in some fractal geometry stuff one of the professors was doing at my institution, and that led to me helping mentor with a project that I will talk about in a video in a few days. So, I don't know if that's a great answer, but that is my current understanding as it is right now as a third semester PhD student who is not actually doing PhD level research at this point yet. I had a question about what types of algebra textbooks are used in grad school. This particular person listed Lang Eisenbud and Atiyah McDonald. So I have heard of both Lang and Atiyah McDonald. but the ones that were used in the classes at my institution were Hungerford for the year that I took it, and then this year they're using Dummett and Foot. And after reading through Dummett and Foot, that is the book that I wish I got to take algebra with. Hungerford is like a reference text. It's not really like a textbook. A lot of the arguments are left to the reader, so if you don't have a good basis for writing algebra arguments already, Hungerford can be a mess to try to dive in. On the other hand, Dummett and Foot does a really good job of proving things along the way and like giving you a substantial amount of an argument for certain major theorems so that you can go back and complete the proofs if need be, or tackle other problems that have similar proof styles required. Other books that I've heard of for algebra are Jacobson's Algebra 1 and Algebra 2. So next, what makes a math PhD application good? What do you recommend to undergrads? In terms of what makes a PhD application good, I don't have a great idea because I don't think I treated the PhD application process the second time around in a great way. And the first time around, I did not have a strong application. Things that I would recommend, though, is that gaps in your undergraduate degree can be problems and can make it harder for you to apply places. The weakest part of my application was the fact that I took a semester off, I dropped my abroad program to come back home and help run a family business while there were some other family things going on. Gaps in your undergraduate degree can look bad, especially if you don't have any work experience after the fact. Take as much math as you possibly can, especially if you can get a full course in real analysis and a full course in abstract algebra in there somewhere in undergrad. Along with that, the best thing that you can do as an undergrad to prepare for math PhD applications, especially earlier on, as in before your senior or junior year, is to start talking to your professors that teach your classes and having a relationship with them. In the fact that like you go to office hours, you can talk to them about math, they see that you have a genuine interest in mathematics. Because later on down the line, you're going to want to be able to go ask people for letters. And if you haven't gone to office hours or haven't talked to these people about math outside of the context of, oh, there's this problem that I don't understand, it makes it harder for them to write you a good letter of rec. Also, again, talking with your professors can lead to opportunities to do different things. So it's always a good idea to talk to your professors. So I guess the final piece of advice I have for math PhD application stuff is that you should try to apply places that are in line with things that you think you want to do. You don't have to know what you want to do going into a math PhD application, but if you, all of the things that you write about in your application are like, ooh, I'm super into number theory, and you apply to a place where most of the people there do like homological algebra, then you're going to have a weird disconnect between your application and people at the institution and what they do, right? So when you write your personal and research statements for these places, you don't necessarily have to know what you want to do, but try to focus it towards things that you enjoy that are similar or related to things that people in that department actually research at the time. Because if you don't, one, you could end up at a place where no one actually works on the things that you think are interesting. Or two, you could be wasting a lot of money applying to places where they won't actually consider your application seriously because you don't actually want to do the types of math that that department actually cares about, if that makes sense. So I probably have more to say, but I'm going to cut it there. So yeah, anyway, if you enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe for more math stuff. I have actual math content on here, and I also talk about grad school things like in this video.